Stumble out of bed and stumble to the kitchen. Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets the traffic starts coming. Folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living. And it's stretching by. It's all it takes and ain't no giving. They just use your mind. Yes, they never give you credit. It's enough that's driving you crazy if you let it. It's 9 to 5. For service and devotion. You would think that I would deserve a better promotion. Won't you move ahead?
And welcome back to Office Hours Live.
Woohoo!
Today is the 26th, the 26th of September. Oh, 27th, I'm sorry, 27th of September. Can it already be the 27th of September? How is that possible? You're live, I am live, and this is live. Make sure, by the way, that when we do this, the whole purpose of doing this is because we are, all of us, alive on the 27th of September. Make sure that you alert others, you share this so that we can have a conversation. And the whole point, again, is to engage in a conversation. What I want to do, though, initially, is talk to you about three things. One is, obviously, the debate last night. Number two is really an issue that arose in the debate that is very, very central, and there's a lot of confusion about it, and that is raising taxes or lowering taxes on the wealthy. Obviously, Hillary Clinton is on one side, Donald Trump is on the other. I want to discuss that a little bit. And then I've got to add a note about the Charlotte, North Carolina police and some of the issues surrounding that I don't think have really got enough attention. All right? Are you with me? We're here? Live? Together? Okay, great. First of all, with regard to the great debate yesterday, you probably watched it, right? I'm not going to add just simply more commentary, except to say this. I think it's important. There is a world of fact and logic and truth and analysis, and that is the world most of us are in, and most of us judge debates by. I mean, that's the traditional way in which we view debates, whether the debates are presidential debates or any other kind of debate. I mean, we pay attention to facts, analysis, logic, and truth. And we have one of the candidates who actually is incredibly adept at dealing with this is not a very flattering picture, with fact, logic, truth, and analysis. And that's what she gave us last night. Hillary Clinton has been dealing with fact, logic, and truth, and analysis for many, many years, and that is her world. I just want to emphasize something. There is another world, and that world is bombast and fiction. And repetition and assertion. And it's a world that we are not accustomed to seeing in debates. And it's a world certainly we're not accustomed to seeing politicians in. A lot of us live in that world, at least some of the time. I mean, can I make a confession, a personal confession? Sometimes I spend a little bit of time in that world. I mean, you know, usually it's personal and usually it's with friends and family, I'm not proud of it, but it's just sort of part of the world I'm in. But with regard to last night's debate, it's clear that there was one candidate who was the candidate of bombast, fiction, repetition, and assertion. That candidate, we all know, was Donald Trump. And there he is. So when you hear, as all of the, I mean, all of the major media and all of the analysts say, and I believe as well, that Hillary Clinton won the debate, she won the debate because of fact, logic, truth, and analysis. I mean, she won the debate on those grounds. But if you are in a different world, I'm just going to make sure that we understand who this is on this side. If you are in a different world, if you are in a world of a bombast and assertion and fiction and repetition, which again is a world that a lot of us spend at least some time in, you might have a different view, or at least part of you, part of your brain might have a different view. Even if the part of your brain, do you understand what I'm saying? That our brains are constructed in a way. There is a rational side of the brain. The rational side of the brain will find that Hillary Clinton won last night. But there is also this other side, it's another hemisphere, or maybe it's the medulla oblongata. I can't remember my biology. It's not. It's something deeper. It's a hypothalamus. What is it? Do you remember? But it doesn't matter, because it is part of the brain where I'm tempted to say it's the reptilian part of our brains. And so when we get into the voting booth, the question is, will a majority of voters in the voting booth do what voters depend on in a democracy, and that is fact, logic, truth, and analysis wins, or how many voters will actually be swayed in terms of their reptilian brain by bombast, fiction, repetition, and assertion? That's operative. Do you understand my point? Is that a useful point? All right. But we can come back to that. In fact, I'm looking forward to your questions. One of the most important issues last night in the debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump was this issue of raising or lowering taxes on the wealthy. It's not a new issue, but I want to make sure that you and I are together on this, and that when you have to deal with your conservative Republican Uncle Joe or whoever you have to deal with, you know the arguments, because they're very important. And Hillary made them, but she didn't make them with due respect quite as clearly as she might have made them. It is important to raise taxes on the wealthy, and there are a number of reasons. Number one, the rates now, even though they were raised during the Obama administration, the rates now, the top tax rate on the wealthy is now about 39.6%. That may sound like a lot, but under Dwight D. Eisenhower, the Republican, in the 1950s, the top rate was 91%. And even the effective rate, when you get rid of and take into consideration all of the deductions and the tax credits, it was still well over 50%. That is, the most wealthy members of our society in the 1950s, even in the 1960s after John F. Kennedy dropped the tax rate a little bit on the wealthy, they were still paying over half of their incomes above that marginal rate in taxes. They thought that was their responsibility. So there's no question that right now the top rate is much, much lower than it has been historically. Again, even though there was a slight increase during the Obama administration. The other point is that we have not had this era of the degree of concentrated income and wealth at the top since the 1920s, and by some measures, since the Gilded Age of the 1880s, 1890s. So where are we going to get the money to do everything we need to do in terms of public investment in education, in infrastructure, in terms of paid leave, everything else that we need? And the boldness of the actual legislation and initiatives that have to occur if we're going to reverse widening inequality and give people an equal opportunity in this country are much larger than even Hillary Clinton is talking about. Where is the money going to come from? The only place where the money is really at the top. And so it is people at the top. Who have the money. That's where the money is, folks. Hello. And the other point that needs to be made is that, Donald Trump last night, when he said that you have to reduce taxes on the top in order to create jobs, that's the opposite of the truth. What you need to do is you need to expand the middle class and the poor in order to create jobs, because their buying power is what creates the jobs. The job creators are not the wealthy. The wealthy don't create any jobs. Jobs are created when there's sufficient demand for goods and services, not just private goods and services, but I'm talking about also public health, environmental protection, everything else, when there's sufficient demand for all of that. And where does the demand come from? Well, a lot of the demand is going to come from the middle class and the poor. They are the ones that spend. If the middle class is contracting, as it has been, and if the poor don't have enough resources and can barely make it, and more of the wealth and income of the country is going to the top, then we're not going to have jobs. It's as clear and as basic as that. And so you need to have more money in the center and in the bottom and not going to the top. And that means you need a tax increase on the top in order to finance everything you need to do to expand the middle class, to invest in education, to invest in infrastructure, to actually build the research and development and all of the basic R&D and all of the other things we need for a vibrant and growing and big middle class, including, by the way, a larger earned income tax credit, which is a wage subsidy for the poor. And finally, number four, this idea that you get economic growth from trickle-down economics, supply-side economics, by reducing taxes on the top. Listen, Ronald Reagan reduced taxes on the top, and George W. Bush reduced taxes on the top. Did we grow faster? No, we grew faster when we had high taxes on the top in the 1950s, 1960s, early 1970s. So this is supply-side economics is a cruel hoax. It's cruel because it is it asserts enormous hardships on everybody except the very, very wealthy. It's a hoax because it doesn't work. And that's what Trump is selling. Are we there? All right. The other thing that I want to talk about I can't resist, because although there's been a lot of analysis and a lot of discussion of what happened in Charlotte, North Carolina last week, the one big issue is not being discussed enough. The contest right now, the big question is, did, in fact, Keith Lamont Scott, who was shot, did he have a gun? That's what, the police are saying he had a gun, and his family and others who were there or are onlookers say he didn't have a gun. But let's assume, for the sake of the argument, that he did have a gun. Now remember, the whole justification for the police moving in on him was that he had a gun. But let me just emphasize with you this stark reality. North Carolina is an open carry state, which means that people have the right to have a gun. Now, I don't think that's good. I'm not endorsing that. I'm just saying that if it's an open carry state and everybody has the right to have a gun, that means that the police don't have any justification for moving in on somebody because they have a gun. Do you get the point? It's a just simple logic point. The only conclusion that you can draw from what's happened in North Carolina is that, yes, everybody has the right to have to carry a gun except black people. In fact, when black people carry a gun, they might be shot dead. All right, let's move on, if we may. Oh, let's move on to your questions, because there are a lot of questions, and I've brought up some issues, but undoubtedly you have questions, and this is the part of our little lecturing. Even at the whiteboard, which I enjoy doing, it doesn't give us a chance to interact. So your questions, please. Okay, question number one. Conrad Miller, will the debate change anyone's mind, or is it just there for ratings? Conrad, I frankly don't think the debate's going to change anybody's mind. I mean, it may change a few minds at the margin, but most people have made up their minds. We'll know in a few days whether Hillary Clinton's small lead, and it's a very, very tiny lead, has expanded, but I frankly doubt that the debate's going to do very, very much. Next question is from Michael Edward. Does it really matter if Trump supported the Iraq war or not, since Hillary also did? Don't get me wrong, I am not a Trump supporter. Michael, it's only relevant, I think, with regard to the issue of Trump's trumping up his own sort of
biography, saying whatever he wants, getting away with bold-faced lies. I mean, there is a lot of evidence that he did say at the time that he was supportive of the Iraqi war. So you're absolutely right. With regard to whether he did vis-a-vis Hillary Clinton, it doesn't matter because she did as well. You know, this is a matter of something that is about character. You know, I thought that the best part of the debate from Hillary Clinton's standpoint yesterday was when Donald Trump went on congratulating himself, complimenting himself on his temperament. You know, one of my greatest assets is my temperament. And Hillary Clinton showing, I thought, real spontaneity and humor and reality, authenticity, basically said, whew, okay. I mean, it was that whew, okay, which I think actually got through to people in a way that many of the arguments and well-rehearsed arguments never get through to people. Next one, Taylor Keyes. Do you think Trump would have gotten as far as he has if the media didn't feature him so prominently, even when they were making fun of him? Taylor, I completely agree with your point that the media have been complicit. Trump knows how to play the media. The media are after ratings. Trump knows how to get ratings, and therefore there is a collaboration going on between the media and Trump. And that's been going on since the beginning of the Republican primary. I think the media have given Trump, in fact, it's not just I think, I know, because there have been a lot of analysis of this, the media have given Trump extraordinary amounts of airtime. And even last night, after the debate, did you notice that Trump went to the spin room? I've never heard of a candidate going directly to the spin room to even get more media time. And if it weren't for the fact that Trump does drive ratings. People like to see him, not because they like him, but because he's such a character. Then I don't think we'd see this degree of complicity. Matt Galuli. Matt, did I get the name right? Galuli? How does Clinton win in working class battleground states such as Ohio and Pennsylvania? Matt, I think the only way Hillary Clinton wins is by talking about what she's talked about at the start of her primary campaign. Do you remember when she started that campaign, she said, the deck is stacked in favor of those at the top. If she goes back to that populist theme about what she would actually do to help average working people, I think it helps her. You know, I'm reminded of the election of 2000. It wasn't until Al Gore began talking about the powerful and the privileged on one side and average working people on the other side, that he started to get traction. It was too late. I mean, he won, obviously, the popular vote, but it was too late to influence much of the electoral vote. But it's that kind of message that people, particularly now, much more even than the year 2000, when we didn't have the gaping inequality we have today and the sense that so many people have with justification that the game is rigged. And I think Hillary Clinton needs to talk about that. I think she needs to talk about money in politics. Yes, it's awkward for her, but she needs to talk about it. She needs to talk about getting big money out of politics, what she would do to get big money out of politics. I think that this theme has power in a way it never used to have power. Julie Benson, how do you get friends and family members who are uninterested in voting to get out and get their voice heard on November 8th? Julie, you got to beg them, plead with them, threaten them. You've got to basically say, this is a very, very important election. Even if you've got to make them fear that if Donald Trump truthfully, and this is not a matter of making anything up, if Donald Trump becomes president, he has the authority of the commander-in-chief and the chief executive of the most powerful nation in the world. 1,800 federal appointments, possibly 4 Supreme Court appointments. He will know the nuclear codes. I mean, do you want somebody, tell your family, do you want somebody like that in charge of your children's and their children's and grandchildren's future? Maria Peronka. Peronkova Irwin. Maria, I don't. Why is third party not an option in this particular election? Maria, it's not an option because the way our Constitution designed our election processes, which is winner take all. I mean, in almost every state, you have the winner of the plurality or the majority winner of a presidential primary gets all of the state electoral votes. And, you know, if you want to amend the Constitution, that's possible. It's difficult to do, and it should be difficult to do. But that's why we don't have a parliamentary system. That's why proportional voting doesn't really work. Jason Galbraith, will the next recession be a financial panic like the last one, or simply the system running out of steam like 2001? Jason, most of our recessions, you are right, most recessions, particularly since the Second World War, and they come every 6, 7, 8 years, we are due for another one, sadly, there's something called the business cycle, are just instances where either the Fed raises interest rates too much or too early, or businesses overshoot in terms of their investments and inventories, or individuals overshoot in terms of getting involved in too much debt, and you don't get a bursting of a bubble. Usually what we have, as you said, is the system running out of steam. I believe that if Donald Trump is elected president, it increases dramatically the chances of a recession soon, because it's going to roil financial markets, it's going to worry global financial markets, and a lot of people, individuals, are going to just put away more of their money, because they're going to say, well, what's going to happen now? That kind of uncertainty, I believe, will lead, or could very, very easily lead to a recession. Otter Truth Boxworth. That's not your name. Otter Truth Boxworth? What are the choices of closing the loophole that allows companies to deduct CEO pay over $1 million? Well, I've been pushing this as hard as I can. I've been talking it up. As you know, in 1992, Bill Clinton, as part of his campaign in 1992, said corporations should not be able to deduct CEO pay from corporate income taxes, CEO pay in excess, or any executive pay in excess of $1 million. And then his advisors stuck in a loophole. And I'm going to tell you just a little bit about that because it's so frustrating to me. I was there, and I was outvoted. You know, Bob Rubin and the late Lloyd Benson and a couple of other economic advisors said, well, the business community is not going to like this, and also it's perfectly okay if the pay is linked to performance. And by performance, they meant stock performance. And so the loophole was corporations can deduct any amount of executive pay from their corporate income taxes as long as it is in the form of stock bonuses or stock options, where it is linked to performance. And that's really the beginning of the explosion in stock options and stock grants, which have been really detrimental. I mean, if you look at some of the problems that have been created in terms of short-termism and you know, Mylan Pharmaceuticals, for example, I mean, it's all over the place. I think Hillary Clinton in the first 100 days, and we're going to be getting into this, the first 100 days, she ought to change that rule. The Treasury has certain discretion. I believe the Treasury could do it on its own, but it would be very popular even if it required legislation. No loopholes. Cameron Kadek, is that right, Kadek? How many markers do you go through in a week? About 5, maybe 20. Okay, Colleen Scully, do you think raising the minimum wage will actually help those who earn more than the minimum, or will the top fat cats just tighten their spending even more in order to keep the money at the top? Colleen, there is evidence that when we do raise the minimum wage, it has a little bit of a multiplier effect upward. Not as much as it used to when 35% of Americans were in trade unions, and when we raised the minimum wage, the union also made sure that the prevailing wage was correspondingly larger and higher. But there is a multiplier effect. I think that the fat cats at the top will do whatever they can to stay fat, however. Susie Hager-Powell, does this mean I don't have to pay taxes either, since I am smart like Trump? You have to pay taxes, Susie. Michael Woods, what are your thoughts and opinions on independence across the nation? For example, for the most part, we, and Michael, I assume you're talking about we, you are an independent, aren't noticed, but do you think it might be the case that the independents are responsible for placing a person in the Oval Office? Yes. Michael, estimates vary, but it's about anywhere between 42 and 52% of the electorate are independent. They are not registered as Republicans or Democrats. And that means the independents have enormous power, and they ought to be voting. It's frustrating to be an independent because you haven't participated in most of the primaries, except for the open primaries. But yes, independent voters are going to make the difference here. Robert Cudler, how did a maniac like Donald Trump penetrate our political system and the minds of so many fundamentally decent people? Robert, sociologists will be having a field day with this for years and years to come. I think, actually, it's related. I'm not an economic determinist, but I do think it's related to the extraordinary frustrations and anxieties and the fact that you've got a lot of working class people in this country. I'm talking about lower middle class people working harder than ever, and they're on a downward escalator. And they've been on a downward escalator for years, and they're beginning to think that their children are not going to live as well as they live. And this is the fodder from which demagogues arise historically, not only in the United States, but around the world, as we saw tragically in the 1930s. I mean, if it's not Donald Trump, it'll be somebody else. And it's that anger and frustration about getting nowhere. Jordan Osijo, can you explain how it's possible for there to be three generations or even five generations of families living impoverished? Jordan, I can explain that because once you are impoverished, or if you're an impoverished family these days, and we know it's been happening for the last several generations, there's more and more concentration of poverty geographically. So if you are brought up poor in the United States, the chances are you have a lousy school because the local tax base can't support a decent school. Chances are it's very hard to get a loan. It's very hard to even pay prices that are reasonable retail prices because everybody around you is poor. The actual rents are, although they are low, the insurance rates that retailers have to pay are going to be very, very high. And what you have is a cycle of poverty that's very difficult to get out. In the United States, a poor child has a 40% probability of staying poor as an adult, which is much higher than any other advanced nation, because no other advanced nation has this degree of concentrated geographic poverty, and no other advanced nation does as poorly by its poor children as the United States. Next question, please. And we have time for two more. Joel Wright, do you ever sleep, Robert? No. Of course I do, Joel. Do you sleep? Ann Kelly, how do you stay so calm? Do you think I'm calm? Am I calm, Ann? I try to stay at least a degree of calm because it's important to understand what is happening. It's important to understand the arguments. It's important to be a participant and engaged in our democratic process and understand where Trump came from, for example, and understand what kind of arguments need to be made. But more importantly, once, please, God and the cosmos, if you don't believe in God, please, once Hillary is president, it is important for you and for me and for everybody else to have a very good idea of what the facts are, what the issues are, what the policies are, what the arguments are, so we can push her and push Congress as hard as possible to do what needs to be done in the future. We have one final question. Oh, we don't even have any more questions. All right. Let me just, before we round up, let me thank once again Zoe Umlaut-Beck for her enormous help. Jobin Gill, also for her help. Yael Bridge, thank you for being here in spirit. Anyway, you couldn't be here today. And thank all of you for tuning in. We'll see you next week.